Well, if you're new to the area and looking for a church family, there, I won't need cough drops before I'm done, all right. In the pew in front of you, there are these cards, and they work on a number of levels. One, if you have prayer requests or some need that way, if you would fill that out, put it into the offering, that way we'll get a hold of it at the office. If you're looking for a church home, we'd love for that to be the case. There's places there to mark. If you would be transferring from somewhere else, you can do that as well. But just let us know, and we'll contact you. If there's prayer needs, and you just want it for us pastors, just put that down. If you're fine with it being a part of our prayer chain, that we have a team of people who pray every week, just mark down that it's a general prayer request, and we can let that group be praying for it as well. I welcome you. I'm glad that you're here. I'm looking out. It's good to see Dana. Dana has our morning prayer, and if you'd come up at this time.
Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we have come to you this morning to worship you on your holy Sabbath day. We have come into your presence to know you better and to deepen our relationship with you. You are our creator, our potter. We are the clay. Mold us. We want to be like you, loving and selfless. Forgive us for when we are unfaithful and proud. Forgive us for when we put other things before you. We are thankful, so thankful, Lord, that you are full of grace and mercy to cleanse us and renew us. We are thankful for the blessings that we enjoy. We are thankful for the privileges of coming before you in prayer at any time, of meeting here together in this church with other believers. You have given us everything we need and more in the gift of salvation through your Son. You've given us your word, full of precious promises of power and of hope. We cannot thank you enough for all the gifts you give. Dear Lord, you've asked us to carry each other's burdens, and you've told us to come to you with them. This morning we are burdened for our friends among us that are suffering with illness, suffering from grief, financial hardship, and other heartaches. This morning we'd like to lift up especially Louise Jensen as she's in the hospital with fluid on her lungs. We think of Bonnie Parle, who's soon to have surgery. We remember the Davy family and Lloyd and Mary Margaret Amy. Lord, we beg you to intervene on their behalf. We ask you to pour out the comfort of your Holy Spirit and to help us know how we can help our brothers and sisters in Christ. Show us also who you want us to reach in this community. Lead us to our own personal mission fields right here in Skagit Valley. And now, Lord, we ask that you'll please guide Pastor Ron as he speaks to us this morning and open our hearts to hear the message that you have for us. Transform us this morning, Lord, in this place, and ignite us with your Spirit. Bless us all so that we may leave this place to bless others. In the name of your precious Son, Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. Today, our first song is going to be Chief of Sinners, 295. God is ready and waiting to forgive anyone who asks. For you, Lord, are good, and ready to forgive and abundant in mercy to all those who call upon you. Psalms 86, verse 5. God will always be waiting for us to return. He says in Isaiah 44, 22, I have blotted out your transgressions like a cloud and your sins like mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. Chief of Sinners, 2:95.
Chief of sinners though I be, Jesus shed his blood for me, died that I might live on high, died that I might never die. As the branches to the vine, I am his and he mine. Oh, the height of Jesus' love, higher than the hand above, deeper than the deepest sea, lasting as eternity. Love that found me wondrous thought, found me when I sought him not. Chief of sinners though I be, Christ is all in all to me. All my wants to him are known, all my sorrows are his own. Sustains the hidden life.
Our next song is My Faith Has Found a Resting Place, number 523, and we will sing verses 1, 3, and 4. Real faith is believing in what Christ has done for us. In Romans 5, verse 1, we read, "So now, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith in his promises, we can have real peace with him because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. My faith has found a resting place." 523, verses 1, 3, and 4.
My faith has found a resting place, not in a man-made creed. I trust the ever-living one, that he for me will plead. I need no other evidence, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me. My soul is resting on the word, the living word of God. Salvation in my Savior's name, salvation through his blood. I need no other evidence, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me. The great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. For me his precious blood he shed, for me his life he gave. I need no other evidence, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me.
Our opening song this morning is "'Tis Love That Makes Us Happy." We will sing, it's number 579, all three verses. God's love lasts forever. It is in the Bible. Psalm 136, verse 1. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. And if you will stand with us this morning.
Tis love that makes us happy, tis love that smooths the way. It helps us mind, it makes us kind to others every day. God is love, we're his little children. God is love, we would be like him. Tis love that makes us happy, tis love that smooths the way. It helps us mind, it makes us kind to others every day. This world is full of sorrows, of sickness, death, and sin. With loving heart we'll do our part and try some soul to win. God is love, we're his little children. God is love, we would be like him. Tis love that makes us happy, tis love that smooths the way. It helps us mind, it makes us kind to others every day. And when this life is over and we are called above, our song shall be eternally of Jesus and his love. God is love, we're his little children. God is love, we would be like him. Tis love that makes us happy, tis love that smooths the way. It helps us mind, it makes us kind to others every day.
Thank you. You may be seated.
It's time for our offerings. The children will be coming by with the lamb's offering and coming up for children's story, and the deacons will be serving for the tithes and the offerings. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord God, I want to thank you for the beauty of this Sabbath day, and I want to ask that your blessing would be on the gifts that we return to you. We are grateful for all that you do for us. Receive these from loving hearts in Jesus' name. Amen.
How would life be different? Would it cause any problems? Would you like that? You guys, what do you think about that? It would make you sad? Why would it be a problem for you?
Why is that a problem?
Well, if you, like, somebody accidentally hit you, you wouldn't be able to ask them to stop.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. Okay.
Well, you don't have a chance to see them a lot. Like my dad, he sometimes he comes a little late, but sometimes I'm lucky and he comes during dinner.
Yeah, so like if your parent came home after dinner, you wouldn't even be able to talk to them if the only time was at mealtimes. Good, Elin?
If you get hurt, then you don't get a chance to tell them.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That's a really good example. Well, you know, sometimes, I don't like to admit it, but there's sometimes where my family and I only talk to God at mealtimes, or maybe when we go to bed. Jesus showed us a different and better way. He prayed at many different times, and he prayed wherever he was. So I'm going to ask some volunteers to come forward one at a time, and I'm going to ask you to turn one of these clocks to a certain time, and then I've got a Bible verse that we're going to read that goes along with the time of the clock, that the clock shows. So let's have, who wants to come up? Zeke, you want to come over here and turn the clock to a certain time? All right, either one of those clocks, you can turn it to a certain time. It's at 4:00. Thank you. Okay, so, Kalea, can you be my person to hand out the envelopes? They have the time on them, okay? So, here we go. I've got a 4:00. Come here, Zeke. We're going to read this verse together, okay? 4:00. This is what it says. You can echo after me. When you pray. You say, when you pray?
When you pray.
You should go.
You should go.
Into your room.
Into your room.
And close the door.
And close the door.
And pray.
And pray.
To your Father.
To your Father.
Who cannot be seen.
Do not seen.
Who cannot be seen. All right. So that's what it says for 4:00. Let's keep reading some more. Anybody else want to come and turn the clock? Elise, come here. All right, Kalea, get ready. You're going to find the... So we've already used 4:00. Let's find another one. We might not get to every hour. Okay, she's set it to, there we go, 6:00. Find the 6:00 one and hand it to Elise. Open it up. You can read it on your own, right? Okay, so here we go. There's a verse in here. Let's read about what it says. Way down in there. All right, you ready?
While they were eating, Jesus took some bread and thanked God for it and broke it.
All right, so he thanked God when? When was this prayer? At mealtime. Good. All right. Can we have another volunteer? Jenna, do you want to come and set the clock? Do you want to choose a time? Yeah? Come on over. All right, you can choose either clock, and we're going to set the time. 7:00. She set it to 7:00. All right, here we go. And Mom, do you want to help her with this one? Okay, here we go. Do you want to help her?
Jesus said to them, "My heart is full of sorrow." Jesus fell to the ground and prayed. Matthew 26:38-39.
So when did Jesus pray for that one? What happened? Maybe kind of like what Elin was saying. Did you hear it? My heart is full of sorrow. So Jesus prayed when he was sad. All right, Levi, come on over. Set the clock. Okay, he's setting, it might start chiming. Yes, now it's going to, okay, 1:00. Kalea, can you find the 1:00 time? All right, Levi, here we go. I'll help you read it, okay? All right, she threw it at you, huh? Okay, here we go.
But Jesus often
slipped away
to be alone.
So he could pray.
So he could pray.
All right. So he slipped away and he was alone. So sometimes we pray when we're alone. All right. Let's do someone else. Eliana, come and set the time. Maybe one that we haven't done. 12. I don't think we've done 12. All right. Go grab the 12:00 envelope from Kalea. All right. Somewhere in there. Found it? All right. Okay, here we go.
He took 5 loaves and 2 fish and and looked to heaven. He thanked God for the food. Matthew 14, 19b.
Very good. Thank you. All right. So when did Jesus pray in that one? Mealtime. That's a common one that we do a lot. All right. Let's do Quinn. Come on over and set the time. Either clock is fine. Yep. You could go around. How about that? 2 o'clock? Okay, 2 o'clock. You have one, Clea? Let's bring it over. Quinn, do you read yet? Let me help you. Let me help you.
I do half reading.
You're doing reading? Okay, well, here we go.
Then the people.
Brought their little children.
To Jesus.
So he could put. His hands on them.
He could put his hands on them.
And pray for them. Good. So when or where, maybe? Where did Jesus pray here in that verse? Yes. Who did he pray for, Jonah, in that verse? Did you hear? He prayed for, you going to say it out loud? The little children in that case. It was a little troll. All right, well, let's do one more, okay? Let's do Ansel. Come on over. I know, all of you wanted a turn. Sorry. I can't always give everyone a turn. Okay, so move the green hand right here. Uh-huh, move that. 8 o'clock. Do you have an 8 o'clock there? Wait, stay here, Ansel, because you're going to read this with me. All right, go grab the 8 o'clock envelope. Bring it over here. All right, this is our last one for today. See what it says. Jesus used
this story
to teach
his followers
that they should always pray
and never lose hope.
Isn't that a great verse? I'm glad we ended with that one, because that's the whole point here, isn't it? That Jesus has taught us that we should pray all the time. And he tells us to do that so we don't lose hope. Our relationships with our own families wouldn't be very good if we spoke to them only at meals, right? It's the same with our relationship with God. Jesus wants us to talk to him all the time. So let's talk to him right now. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for listening to us at any time of the day, no matter what's going on in our lives, and for caring about us and for loving us and answering our prayers. We love you, Jesus. Amen. All right. We'll see you next week. Bye.
Looking forward to VBS. And by the way, I don't know if you know it, but we have a lot of retired railroad workers in this church. Just seems natural that they should be volunteers. So let's volunteer them. They could give us insights that we would not normally have. And I know this is a fact. But anyway, I hope that you will volunteer. Those of us who had the opportunity as children to go to VBS know just how it leaves an impression. I still remember them to this day, and I don't remember a lot. So it's a great opportunity for them to have God's word in their heart and that experience. I forgot that we have the second reading from our nominating committee today. And I would ask, well, first of all, I want to thank the nominating committee. I would say I've been around nominating committees a lot in my life. I think it was a little more challenging trying to do this, going through this COVID journey. And I just want to thank everyone who has accepted, grateful for it. So is there a motion that we would accept the nominating committee's report? So moved. Is there a second? All right. All those in favor, please say aye. Any opposed? That is carried. We've had lots of graduations, and we were able to recognize some, but at this time, we have two that we get to recognize.
Actually, more than that. We have recognized our eighth graders and our high schoolers, but our college and university graduates, a lot of them graduated the first weekend of camp meeting, which you know was not a high service. This is the first chance that we have had.
It was a high service, just not well attended. Okay.
Sorry, well attended. Thank you for correcting my well attended. There weren't a lot of people here. So now this is the first chance that we have had to recognize our college and university graduates. And we have two of them here, but we had a whole lot of them that graduated. So I am going to ask Narada and Ashlyn to come up, but I'm going to talk about the others while they're doing that. We had Bailey Schmidt graduate from Weimar College with a BA in religion and an emphasis on theology. Kelly Hamlin, Vicki Jacobs' granddaughter, is that right? No? Okay. Graduated from Montana State University with a Master's of Science in Special Education. And Benya Wilson, Marge Wilson's granddaughter, graduated from Southern with a BA in History. Aubrey Carambo graduated from Walla Walla with a degree in engineering. John Cotter graduated from Walla Walla with a BS in mathematics. Kensington Lang graduated from Montana State University. And we sent them all gifts, but we have two here today to receive them in person.
By the way, that's pretty impressive, that list, isn't it? Now, these gifts have tassels, and you're an educator. So when you receive these gifts, I would like you to turn the tassel from one side of the box to the other.
Narada, we're very proud of you. She graduated with her master's in education.
Master of Education in Special Education.
Awesome. And Ashlyn, you graduated with, I'm going to let you tell them.
My Bachelor of Science in Nursing.
Awesome.
And
so
she takes her boards on Monday, and we would appreciate praying
on Monday. Definitely. You've got us. We've got your back, girl. All right. Let's give them a hand.
Thank you.
the time of Christ was near that the people couldn't see what Messiah to be. Though your word contained the plan, they just could not understand. Your most awesome work was done in the frailty of your Son.
Thank you very much. So we're in our summer series, the Red Letter Summer, and last week we were in John chapter 8, and it was the question was, who's he to you on Jesus? And the most important question really there is. This week I read my e-newsletter, which I should do all the time, and I saw the worship that Buffy shared. And it really fit what we were talking about last week and will be a great bridge into what we're going to do today. So would you share that with us?
So for those of you who have read this, I am sorry, but a lot of people don't get the newsletter or have time to read it. So
if they want to get the newsletter, how should they?
There's a place at the bottom of the website that you can sign up to get it. It keeps you updated on everything that's happening. Now, there seems to be a problem if you have subscribed at one time and unsubscribed with that email address. So there's lots of times won't let you resubscribe, so you may have to use a different one.
Or just fill out it and put it.
Well, it's hard. We can't do it either right now. So anyway, we'll work on that. We had the SAA golf tournament last Sunday. It was fun. First, you need to know that I have only played golf one time in my life, a couple of years after we got married. So when Tyler Long sent me a text inviting me to be on his golf team, I laughed. The invitation was too good to be true, though. I had nothing to lose. His text said, "I'd like you to play on our team, all expenses covered. I can even bring an extra set of golf clubs for you." I replied that he had no clue what he was getting himself into. He assured me that we were just going to have fun. At the last minute, Ron couldn't go, so our team was comprised of Tyler, LaVon's father, Brian, and Brian's cousin, Jess. I just want you to know that I won the first golf tournament that I ever played in. Well, my team did. But because I was on the team,
and I wasn't there,
I won too. Last Sunday, while SAA benefited from the tournament, I lived a beautiful example of grace. I couldn't have won that golf tournament on my own to save my life.
All I did was say yes. I joined the team. I enjoyed the company. We laughed a lot. We did the Eagle Dance several times. We got to know each other. We drove around looking for balls that had gone off course. We had snacks and cold drink along the way. We used a couple of mulligans and some red yarn. I had no clue that the strategy that went in to each hole. I tried to hit the ball each time it was my turn, and initially it took me several swings to even connect with the ball. But by the end of the game, I was doing a little better. I even hit it straight once. Not very far, but straight. By the end of the game, it was a lot better. But each time the instructions that they gave me were the same. You know what they are, right? Keep your eye on the ball. Now, I made a horrible mess of that golf game, but I won because of who I knew, whose team I was on. This is exactly how our everyday life should look. Jesus invites us to be on his team, and we really have no skill, but he's paid the price. He just wants us to be with him, and all we have to do is say yes and join his team, and we get all the benefits of being on his team. The gift of each other, companionship, friendship, laughter, doing life together, Holy Spirit power, peace and joy and love, and all we have to do is keep our eyes on Jesus. Stay close, and I promise that we'll win the tournament and enjoy the journey. It's called grace. Amazing grace.
Thank you. Last week, we found Jesus in a fight. And sadly, that fight started earlier, continued on until his death. The hottest fights were usually when he was in Jerusalem. They were usually at a time when it was supposed to be a special spiritual high time for the nation. And we were at the Festival of Tabernacles last week. For those of you not here, just catch you up. Some people have said that Jesus never claimed to be God, and I hope you walked away or shut your little device off knowing absolutely Jesus' claim to be not only Son of Man, but Son of God as well. I introduced you to two Greek words, egoemi. And if there was any doubt by the time you were done, and we talked about at the tabernacle time, time where they remembered their time in Egypt. Oh, by the way, we're doing it a little different this summer. It was supposed to be shorter, forgive me. You know, because I'm more relaxed as a family. But I loved teaching Jesus in the Gospels. And I'm not giving the whole, I'm not even using my lectures. They would be too long. But I want to dig into the word in a way that I tried to with my students. Because when I took Jesus in the Gospels, we hardly opened our Bible. That's not a knock. My teacher was a godly person. But they were so busy with all the technicalities, they never really got to the word. And so when I could teach it, my whole thought was, we're going to be in here every day, big time. The Festival of Booths was a reminder of when they were in the wilderness. Important things would be said at that. Manna, the bread from heaven, living water that saved them in the wilderness, and light, the light of life, the reminder of the pillar of fire by day. And Jesus said important things to them. He said, I am the bread come down from heaven. They knew what he was saying. I am the name for God. He said, I am living water. I am. There was even a special service where they went down to the Pool of Siloam to get water to bring back as part of it and pour it out in front of the altar, a priesthood, and that living water would flow from the altar. All this is about Jesus. I am the light of the world. And at the end, they called him all sorts of things, a demon-possessed Samaritan, which was as bad as the Israelites could say it. At least we know our parents calling him other names. And then they said to him at the end of the chapter, you are not even 50 years old and you have seen Abraham. And he leaves no doubt when he says, I tell you the truth. Before Abraham was, I am. And they picked up stones because they wanted to kill him. The people of God who said they'd look for Messiah to come all those years, and when he comes, they are not ready and they want to kill him. But it wasn't his time. He will not die at the Feast of Tabernacles. He will die at Passover. And not just any time at Passover. He will die on that Friday evening sacrifice. That vital sacrifice. And it will be just so. And it's all about Jesus. But who is he to you? I was going to just move along, but I couldn't. So we're going to pick up here in chapter 9. And I'm going to read from the ESV today, since we're covering so much Scripture. Also, it's the one I happen to be going through this time through Scripture. I mainly have grown up King James, New King James. I try to read different versions sometimes when I go through, because I've been blessed to go through the Bible many times, but I don't want to do it on autopilot. And sometimes if you'll read another translation, it will just make you slow down enough. Verse 1. And he passed by and saw a man blind for how long? From birth. His disciple has asked him, Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents that he was born blind? I always found myself hoping that the blind man wasn't so close to them to hear him, because I know that these disciples of Jesus are lousy witnesses. Do you hear me? And we just repeat the story too. I found with those I know blind, they often are very good at hearing. Seemed like the disciples were always keeping people from Jesus rather than bringing people to him. Pharisees are not good witnesses, and neither are disciples that have not been humbled by the cross and given a new life by the resurrection. They ask a question that Pharisees and rabbis and others fought about, who sinned, this man or his parents? They were concerned with the wrong things. They should have been concerned with the man, and they were concerned with the sin. They also believed that his illness and his problem was caused by sin. And it was. But you know what? If we were all given stuff for our sins, we'd all be blind, deaf, and dumb. Do you hear me? We've all been impacted by sin, and we will all die if Jesus doesn't come before because of sin. But we can all live in Christ because of Jesus. But you have to accept him and on his terms. They had all kinds of teachings. So I'm going to give you some Bible background. From the Mishnah, Samson went after the desire of his eyes, therefore the Philistines put out his eyes, quote. You get this, follow this. Absalom gloried in his hair, beautiful hair. Therefore he got caught and hanged by his hair, and because he slept with 10 of his father's concubines, he was stabbed with 10 lances, and because he stole 3 hearts, the heart of the father, the heart of the court of justice, and the heart of Israel, there were 3 darts thrust into his heart, the Talmud. There were even a minority that taught that babies in the womb could sin. It wasn't the majority, but there was a minority that taught it. And so the question comes about this man who's born blind, who sinned, this man, or so? I guess if you kick your mom too many times before you're born, you're a sinner. Or is it your mom who had anchovies and hot sauce before bed? Who sinned? That was in the Midrash, which could be rash. So they knew these arguments, but instead of caring about the man, they cared about a theological discussion. And it is dangerous, because in the church, that's what we can become like. Jesus said, it was not this man's sin or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. night is coming when no one can work. That's still true. So let's work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And then the grossest miracle in all of the Bible happens. As a kid, this gave me the EBGBs, and I don't even know what EBGBs are. I could not stand this. It just made me cringe because my mom didn't have hairspray. She had spit. And when it came time for church, I mean, this miracle happens on a Sabbath. And when this would happen to me, it was always on a Sabbath. I might have a rooster tail and she'd spit and put, oh, I have PTSD, post-traumatic spit disorder. And it just, I hated it. I even had a theological argument. Mom, leave it up. Let it point people to Jesus. But don't spit on me. And I thought, why? I mean, I've seen Jesus in the Bible. Be well. You know? Even touch me, please. But don't spit in the dirt and make mud. And put it into my blind eye. And Jesus was always intentional. People are like, well, why did he do this? This is not hard. Israel had made, it seems like, thousands of rules around the Sabbath. Man-made rules with the hopes that, it started out well-meaning, I think, that if we put enough rules here, they may break ours, but they won't get to the tenth one end. But I have never found a time when God's people try to help God out that it works or ends well. Some people try to make it like, well, this is Jesus saying the Sabbath doesn't matter. No, I say it's the opposite. He's saying it does matter, and I'm taking it back. The Sabbath was made for man. This is my gift for you. In fact, in Hebrews 4, it's used as an illustration for righteousness by faith. So if you understand the Sabbath right, you should joy in it. You should rest in it, just like your salvation in Jesus. Is it a joy to you? They had 38 categories, laws about the Sabbath, and lots of laws under them. And Jesus is breaking their law of mixing. So let me just tell you a few of their rules. If your house caught on fire, you could go out. It's a Sabbath. In what you're wearing, hopefully you're wearing all three suits that week. But you couldn't go back in and get more out. You could have a Gentile do it. Hey, would you go get my laptops in there? You could have three ropes connected. They wouldn't have had camels. It would have been too expensive. But you could have three ropes with donkeys or something in your hand. And if the ropes weren't touching, you didn't sin. But if you closed your hand, you had committed sin because you broke the category of weaving. The one here is mixing. You could pour water on grain for your animals, but you couldn't mix it. You couldn't mix anything. And Jesus, it is the Sabbath day, and you will find major healings on the Sabbath day, and you will find a war over them, and that is what happens here. This is probably the Sabbath right after the Feast of Tabernacles. A blind man's been blind from birth. By the way, you do not help someone that is not in a life-threatened situation. This is how bad. If you're going to break your leg or arm, don't do it on Sabbath. Because you let it be till sundown. You get that? You're not allowed to reset it before sundown. You have a toothache? I didn't even know if this worked. You couldn't suck vinegar through your teeth to help calm the pain, but if you had vinegar, happened to have had it for that Sabbath lunch, you're okay. You get this? And Jesus heals person after person, and he does it on Sabbath, and not one of them is in a life-threatening situation. Why? Because he didn't care about the Sabbath? No, because he hated the mockery that his people had made of it. And he spit on the ground. He mixed up the mud. Never did this anywhere else, did he? put it on his eyes, and then he goes, said, go wash in Siloam. So he's probably near the temple precinct in Siloam. They're close. And this man was a beggar. That's how you lived then if you were blind. And he makes his way, and he hasn't even seen Jesus. He sends him to sent. I think John was having fun with this because that's what Siloam means. There was a viaduct that brought water in from outside, brought it to the pool of Bethesda. He went back, he washed, and came back in verse 7, seeing. The neighbors and those that had seen him before as a beggar were saying, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some said, it is he. Others said, no, but it's like him. You know, sometimes people that are hurting and down and low are the ones on scene. I think some of them didn't recognize because they never really paid attention. They were always down. They always looked down as they begged and held their hand up, even if they're blind, because you're humbling yourself, right? He kept saying, I am the man. So they said to him, then how were your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus, he knew his name, made mud and anointed my eyes. And by the way, this might blow your mind, you were not allowed to have most of the anointings there were on the Sabbath, only a sacred few. I mean, you can see why. I mean, who wants anointings to take place on God's day? Sick. A man called Jesus said, go to Siloam and wash. So I went, I washed. I received my sight. He's testifying right away. He said, they said to him, where is he now? He said, I do not know. And this gets to be a problem. If you had any kind of Sabbath joy, people had to bring the Pharisees to ruin it for you. Okay, so here's the deal. Okay, you might be a Pharisee if something beautiful and a miracle happens on the Sabbath and you're upset that it did. You just might be a Pharisee. And we know we really need to search our hearts and pray, because this whole idea that the Pharisees were only back in Jesus' time, one of the biggest lies, we keep repeating the same stories. If you are not happy and joyful at the good things Jesus does for someone else because of your hang-ups, you just might be a Pharisee. And if you are, here's the fact, and Jesus made it, who did he have the hardest time with? Sadducees, yes. Sanhedrin, yes. But Pharisees in there. The ones that claimed so much and had so much biblical truth and were right about a lot of things were wrong about the most important thing. And that is why Jesus would in one place say, you are the blind leading the... That's not good. I worked at blind camp. We all had a practice. I was a counselor, and I had a disgusting, devious sicko of another counselor who was my guide. Wore a thing, I couldn't see a thing, and I'm in the Rocky Mountains, and he's leading me near ledges. So anyway, who's leading you matters. So they called the Pharisees. They asked him how he received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes, I washed. See, he wasn't supposed to do that either. He wasn't supposed to wash. And I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. Who created the Sabbath? Others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? There was division among them. They're like, how can this be? So they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him since he opened your eyes? He said, he's a prophet. He hasn't even seen him. He knows that this guy has to at least be a prophet. On the hierarchy of stuff, this guy's a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man. I mean, can you imagine doing this? I mean, talk about raining on this guy's beautiful miracle parade. He has had his sight given back to him, and he's in court. Sounds like injustice of the world, doesn't it? Can even be in the church. How then does he now see? His parents answered. Okay, they're being careful here, and you're going to know why. We know that this is our son, that he was born blind, but how he now sees, we do not know, nor do we know how who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. This is safe. He will speak for himself. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews. Okay, you got to know, this isn't just, when they say fear the Jews, this capital letter, they're Jews. When they do this, and it's Jews talking about Jews, it means these are Sanhedrin Jews. These are the judgmental, they were they? The judging Jews and leaders of the nation. His parents were feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone, so the leaders of the nation all agreed, if anyone should confess, what? Confess Jesus? And that's how you're saved, right? So they're making a law to keep people from being saved. If anyone should confess Jesus to be the Christ, that's not his surname, that is the title for Messiah. He would be put out of the synagogue. That doesn't mean, hey, deacons, we've got someone disrupting, take them out. That means excommunication. It was the human way of saying you can't be saved because we say you can't be saved. And the reason these religious leaders were saying he couldn't be saved was because he claimed the one and the only one who could save him. How messed up is this? Therefore, the parents said, he's of age, ask him. Second time, they called on the man who had been blind and said, give glory to God. Now, if you don't know, you're like, what's this about? This would be our way of saying, do you swear to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God. This is a quote from Joshua chapter 7 or 9, where Joshua is interrogating Achan. And he's telling him, you tell the truth. So they've made a court case out of his healing, and they are now cross-examining him, and they tell him, you're under oath, basically. You tell the truth. Give glory to God. And he's been trying to give glory to God. Don't be surprised if you try to give glory to God, and there are some people who say they're God's best friends, and they don't like it. I don't think this blind man was able to have an education. It was a hard enough thing to come by, but my, can this guy answer questions? They said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. They're calling Jesus a sinner. Our only hope of salvation. If Jesus is a sinner, we're all dead. How do you call the one you said you wanted? He answered, whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. What was one of those things that Jesus read in Nazareth? I have come to set the captives free, to heal the blind. It's being fulfilled, and they're angry that God's word in Isaiah is being fulfilled. What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I've told you already, and you do not listen. Yeah. Pharisees are not good listeners. They're better talkers. I've got to be careful. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered, I have told you, you don't listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Then he gives them a jab that I love. You know, this is kind of a holy Jesus jab. Do you also want to become his disciples? Which tells you that he already considered himself a disciple of Jesus Christ. Isn't that beautiful? So while they're going to excommunicate him, doesn't matter, because Jesus trumps all church leaders. And that's good for church leaders. Man. We know that God has spoken to us through Moses. Said they're disciples of Moses. They've said all kinds of things earlier. They said they're Aaron's children. Then they said they're God's children. They're always throwing these big names around. But I think if that Moses had been there, heard them talking about the Messiah the way he was, he might have taken his staff out again to hit something. We know that God's spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, why is this an amazing thing? You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God, he will do his will. God listens to him. So now he uses their arguments that God only listens to good people, and how did this miracle take place then? Never since the world began, he's really going now. He's starting to preach. He's going to be kicked out of church, so he's getting it in. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. You see why Jesus had to be careful not to come back to Judea too quick and why he waited with Lazarus, right? This is Judea. They want him dead, and it's where the Sanhedrin hang out. If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. And a testimony. They answered him, you were born in utter sin. That's vegetarian cussing. You were born in utter sin, and you would teach us? Their arrogance. And they cast him out. And that's not just saying, hey, leave, give us back your bulletin. You're out of it. You're out of it. Jesus heard. Look at the beauty of Jesus. You will never find anyone greater, better, more beautiful than Jesus. Look what he does. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, that means he sought him. He seeks him. Because that's what Jesus does. He's out to save us, and he seeks us till he finds us. So get this, the one that the temple was all about, this guy's kicked out of it. So the temple comes to him. Do you believe in the Son of Man? There's that title again. He answered and said, who is he, sir, that I might believe in him? Jesus said to him, you have seen him. It is he who is speaking to you. Jesus claims Messiah. Son of God, Son of Man, both. Notice he didn't do it right in front of the Pharisees, or they'd been looking for stones again. He said, Lord, I believe. That's how you get it. Do you get it? The ones who supposedly could see, couldn't see, and the guy that got mud in his eyes was the only one out of that group that actually could see. Oh, the irony. Lord, I believe. He worshiped him, because that's what you do when Jesus has saved you. And you know, God is so good that we worship him, but you know who it helps the most, don't you? It's just like when you give to him, he doesn't need your puny. I don't care if you're rich. Here's heaven. Oh, I'm a millionaire. What's that? Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I came into the world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. And it's not that he wants anyone blind. What he is saying here is, I can heal you if you're blind, if you know you're blind. But if you're blind and you think you can see, you're not going to let me touch you. Huh? Some of the Pharisees nearby heard him. I love that. It's good. Are we also blind? Shouldn't have asked. Really should have just kept your mouth shut. Are we also blind? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. I'm a little more Halvorsen than Jesus. But it's just as powerful. It's more powerful than my voice. But now that you say we see, your guilt, and when the Savior of the world tells you your sins are not forgiven, then I'll tell you what, I don't know a bunch, but you are not forgiven. The one person on earth you do not want looking at you and saying, your sins remain, is Jesus. Because he's going to die to save sinners. And if he tells you that, you must be lost. And the ones that had more Bible knowledge, remembered more Bible verses, were the ones who rejected him the most when he came. And that scares me. I like when we are called the people of the word. But we had better be the people of the grace and the spirit as well. Or there is no light in us worth having. And Jesus said, you go all around the world to make a disciple. And when you do, you make him twice the devil of hell. Why? Because they didn't have some of their Bible facts right? No, because they would not recognize the Savior of the world and they would not accept grace. So who is Jesus to you? Not going to get away with, oh, he's a nice man. Great moral teacher. The Mr. Rogers of the Bible. They didn't kill him because he was Mr. Rogers. They killed him because they knew he was claiming to be God. And they said he had called out blasphemy. But if you are God, it's not blasphemy. It's just a fact. I got carried away. So we land the plane. Do you have a hard place in your heart? I wrote this to me first. Do you have a hard place in your heart today? It's time to let Jesus heal you. Is there a blind spot in your soul? It's time to let Jesus heal you. The healed one asked them, do you also want to be his disciples? Today I am in the Word, with the Word and the Spirit, and I'm asking you, will you truly be one of his disciples? Answer yes. No one else can do it for you. Answer yes. Don't remain blind. Answer yes for today, not tomorrow, not some unguaranteed time in the future, but today is the day of salvation. You have this day, you have this moment, and Jesus through his word and the spirit is saying, I want you to be my disciple. Follow me. Follow me. Lord God, I'm saddened so often. I read through your word, it helps me so much and it makes me sad too. I look at the wandering, but then you kind of remind me that I'm in there too. I see those teachers of the law hurting people in your name and denying you to your face. And I don't want that to ever be me. I surrender whatever it is, Lord. You know, show me. Touch me in the deepest place. Heal my sight by way of my heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.